Shalom and welcome, Salamta, Rastafari, and all those tuning in to these and the live video messages. And this is concerning majorities. For all those not well acquainted with truth, we are referring to what in Babylon, corrupt establishment kingdom, or spiritual Egypt, at times even recognized as the United States of America, what is regarded as minorities. In confusion, in truth, majorities. And so, and most of all, most importantly, the need to open our mouths, you see, and that's the main message, to speak truth, because it does help. You may not affect the individual to whom you are directing the truth to, but you might be sitting in the bus and there might be someone in back of you that catches on to truth, you know. You might be in the park and there might be a jogger that happens to jog by, and you might be that which sparks the fuse, not to destruction and explosion, right? But rather to inner enlightenment. And so it is important to open the mouth, because you loosen truth on earth, and it is loosened as well in the heavens, right? And so the more truth is proclaimed and made manifest into from thought to vibration to energy, the faster we get this Jah world order in place, you know, and start being and start living a life of joyfulness, right? But we need to speak. You see, it doesn't matter if the individual targeted does not catch on to a good influence. But be sure that speaking truth will never be made, will never have been in vain, right? Truth will always be victorious, regardless if you're speaking out to no one. You know, it's still that energy and that vibration is still made manifest, and it is a force to be reckoned with, you know? The vibrations and the energy of truth is way far, it's far beyond that which evil could ever even attain. So it does, a little bit of truth being spoken does away with a lot of evil. And so, you know, keep that in mind. And the reason I say this is because I spoke to an acquaintance which I had not spoken to for a while because of his lack of making his will obedient to good influences. And so one of the first subject matters during our reasoning is him letting I and I know that, you know, there has been some good that has come out of our reasonings. He let I and I know, right? And so he asked that, like, have you heard anything about the recent California prisoners meal strikes? And we answered no. And he went on to mention that because of some of the information and knowledge that we have shared with him, that he passed it on to another acquaintance of ours, and which happens to live a life of incarceration, you know, accustomed to that programming. And so to that systematical programming, right, that the majorities are accustomed to. And so this individual I was speaking to made mention that he had informed our other acquaintance on subject matters or issues such as the William Lynch letters and the whole white supremacist attempt and so on and so forth, some of those kind of topics. And so then he went on to mention that, you know, that he in fact played a big role on getting the ball rolling as far as the prison meal strikes, right? That he really pushed forward. And so what I'm trying to say is that how a little truth can go a long ways. It's not to say that whether what he did was right or wrong, I don't even know, right? But it's more than that. It's some of these individuals are accustomed to that lifestyle. They've been programmed since kinder, you know. It starts with the detentions, with the suspensions, with the facing the wall, with the, you know, not participating, being punished. All of a sudden, it's like, it's not really difficult to to feel comfortable in a room alone when all your life you've been put in similar punishment, kind of like you've been put in that similar situation all throughout your life growing up, you know? And so basically it's the programming. But anyways, it's to say that a little bit of truth, even enlightened these individuals to go forward and push for a more progressive or a more suitable or comfortable life within the lifestyle they actually have. And so, you know, so be it. So they're imprisoned, but the will to even make their imprisonment even better is pretty it's to show that you know, even under tough circumstances, when the truth is spoken, it gives others an opportunity that they did not have. How much more is it empowering to give others the opportunity of salvation by speaking the truth in Gita Jesus Christos? You know, it's not even about him I'm kind of like agreeing with you. It's more like you're giving the world an opportunity to something that maybe that most likely has never been offered. So let I read a little bit of it was on the newspaper and stuff like that. So 43 inmates at Calipatria, that is actually a part of the south border, what is commonly referred to as the Imperial County or Valley, Southern California. Now, 43 inmates at Calipatria State Prison, a part of statewide inmate hunger strike. And so this is going on throughout the state of California. 43 inmates at Calipatria State Prison are among the 639 inmates throughout the state continuing to stage a hunger strike, an official said Monday. The Calipatria State Prison inmates are mostly Hispanic and have been on the hunger strike since September 26th, said Terry Torton, blah, blah, blah. So this was 2011, October 11, 2011. Now, a prison inmate said to be on a hunger strike anytime he misses 9 consecutive meals. Thornton said last week as many as 1,244 inmates were a part of the hunger strike. Okay, first of all, the article is kind of, it's not even that I'm not great at reading, it's kind of, it doesn't make that much sense, but nonetheless, you know, the reason behind the current strike is unknown. Well, you know, well, let me continue reading. Thornton said, but is believed to be tied to the July 1st Pelican Bay prison hunger strike, where a core of 5 demands that included an end to solitary confinement were at issue. Well, it's obvious, you know. Well, not to those in confusion, right? But us that are well acquainted with truth is that people want a better standard of living, you know. And so if they are accustomed to living in incarcerated, then they even want to, you know, increase the standard of living incarcerated, you know. It's more power to them, you know. Even beyond that, I'd like to make mention that Hispanic, because it mentioned mostly Hispanic, right, but not completely, that Hispanics and Ethiopians, or, you know, in confusion referred to as blacks, must come to a union. They must, you know, they must, you see, I've even spoken with you know, acquaintances that happened to be imprisoned often, and, you know, we've mentioned that the blacks or the Ethiopians are not our enemies. And they respond by saying, we know, but those are the rules. And so, you know, it's time that we kind of do away with that, because that is also a William Lynch rule. It's systematically embedded in the minds of the inmates, you know, because the warden and all of them know what's going to happen if black and brown come together, and being that they are the majority, you know, of all inmates. And so now that we're in the subject matter of prisons, let I also make mention that prisons are a business, and they make pretty good money. They're run, even the positions held by the gang members and all that, they're all political, U.S. governmental positions. Everything, they have House majorities, they have representatives, they have a Congress, they have the same rules, same positions, same names, majority House rules and stuff like that, wherever your geography is, and the majority population in within the prison will run that facility, and you know, it's identical to how the American the Babylonian American corrupt establishment government works, you know, something like that, right? It's exactly the same, and nothing happens without the warden knowing. And so every fight, everything, it's all organized, you know. When you walk in through those gates, the first thing that you're told, and probably by a correctional officer, is that you got two options. You either follow the rules of the prison, being the rules of the inmates, or our rules, right? But they don't really kind of like recommend that you follow their rules. As a matter of fact, they don't even they allow everything to happen. You see, they're not trying to get people corrected, they're trying to get people comfortably established so that they don't ever leave, because that is their welfare, that is the money that this institution is going to make, that it's going to receive from the prisoners. And so they've even referred to it as the industrial prison complex. And think about it, prisons, you know, probably sometimes get a help from taxpayers, and so the politicians that push for certain laws kind of tie into a new prison being made, and sometimes even they're even able to acquire free land or tax money to build the facility. And then either the politicians are acquainted, or they themselves own the companies that are going to build the prisons. And then they're quick to fill them up. As a matter of fact, you know, on most prisons in California, it's to the point where the gyms and stuff like that are turned into like a makeshift dormitory, you know, and things get more dangerous and more out of order and stuff like that. But anyways, even further, expounding on this subject matter, you get slave labor, because you pay inmates like, I don't know, 10 cents, 15 cents an hour to work all day. And so now you're getting your other friends, you know, and I'm speaking on corrupt politicians, they get their friends that endorse their campaigns to get kind of like free labor, right? And there is a whole, the same politician friends' companies, or at times even their own companies, have to make the beds, have to make the clothing, have to make the food and the catering and all of that. It's a business. Supposedly in California, the first for-profit institution, facility, correctional institutional facility, whatever they call them, prisons, or as the brethren said, concentration camps, was San Quentin, supposedly the first for-profit prison. But I'm pretty sure that there has been way more before that. And county prisons are actually for profit, and they're privately owned. And what happens is that the state and the federal government kind of like pays private corporations to kind of like establish a county, a sheriff's department of corrections, so that the state and the federal don't have to deal with it. And you guys kind of figure out how you're gonna deal with it, but so it's kind of like the it's like the state and federal government are catching like a break, and so and the sheriff's county department of corrections kind of like steps up to the plate to make some money. And KPBS San Diego radio station is pretty good. I'm gonna speak on a I guess like it was either on one of their daily shows called Fresh Air or All Things Considered, but they had a show where they were speaking on, I'm not sure what they called it, but it had to do with this with profit for profit prisons. And I tried to look up the article online and I couldn't find it. I'll continue to look for that. But that one was speaking on prisons in the South, in Alabama, Georgia, Tennessee, and like South Carolina, probably like all that area, right? And so it's like the jails, they kind of like didn't they even go through call conferences, and they're trying to look for, well, I need a mechanic, do you have a mechanic? Oh yeah, we got an inmate that does that is working on mechanics. Okay, well, I need two caterers. You want to make a trade? And they make the trade, and so their job is to keep those prisons full, those jails full, and they're talking about this. I mean, I'm not kidding, I'm not joking. They're talking about this like nothing. And then of course, the interviewer, she makes mention, in this case it was a she made mention like, well, doesn't this kind of like she remarked, kind of like trying to, not really trying to get the truth out of him, but kind of she had to not sound that bad. So she makes mention like, aren't people gonna think that this is wrong or something like that? And the sheriff goes on to answer, oh no, ever since the that jail facility, we've increased our armament, and we have new cars and new guns and all of that. And so I'm thinking like, wow, like no one can. It's confusion, right? It's Babylon's system. They don't get it. They hear that and are like, oh yeah, then it must be really good. Yeah, they should totally keep on pushing forward that agenda. And so, but I'm letting all Rastafari know, because Hispanics and blacks do fill up the prisons. I had a political science teacher, made mention Paris Hilton and the fact that he was trying to prove that whites and colored are treated equally, right? And he makes mention that Paris Hilton got arrested, and that she pulled out a bag of cocaine and said it wasn't hers or something. I don't know what kind of delusional point he was trying to prove, right? But I made mention, listen, if anyone colored, if any majority, so much as even kind of like hints at wanting to move, much less to put his hand in a pocket or something, he gets shot. He don't, it's true. If you so much as kind of move your hand, you get shot, because he was trying to reach for a weapon, and that's probable cause, and so that's justified, and case closed. And so I don't know why he even brought Paris Hilton up, right? He even mentioned that she even got the opportunity to reach all the way, I don't know if to a bag or her bag or something like that, look for it and bring out the sack of coke and say, oh, this was in my purse or something. I don't know whose it is. And she gets away with it like nothing, right? But who, honestly, I don't really care. But if a majority happens to scratch his head, he could get shot. He could get shot because he's attempting, he's re either resisting arrest, or he's attempting, he was reaching for a weapon. Basically, that's what they're gonna say. And just to conclude this, because we already went way off topic, I want to make mention that I, a former coworker, his children were in the highway patrol and stuff like that, And one time I heard him speaking like, "No, yeah, if I were a cop and I pull someone over and he makes a move, I'd shoot him like 100. I'd shoot him plenty of times right there, right then and there." And I turned around, right? And the other coworker was kind of like sane enough to be like, "What? Nah, man. Why would you do that? That's wrong." And the coworkers that his son was a highway patrol, he makes mention, "No, you don't understand. During my son's training, they showed us all kinds of videos. You better shoot them, or else it's you." And so I'm thinking, man, I bet you anything, I could almost assure that they were probably like locked up in a room with surround sound, big screen TV, if not even a cinema theater, and with like 10 hours of nonstop, like criminals shooting cops or something like that, resisting arrest and stuff, to program, to condition their minds so that if anyone so much as breathes the wrong way, that they pull out their weapon and shoot them, right? And so I can't recall what I went on to mention, but just to show what the system kind of like, it's not like if we don't know, right? But just wanted to include that in there because watch out, you get pulled over by CHP or something, like the highway patrols or something. Honestly, you gotta be like, "May I please have permission to move my right hand over across, to the other seat and grab my wallet that is right next to the Aquafina, I guess like the medium-sized water bottle, And then you gotta tell him that, oh, and I'm gonna open the wallet now, because you never know. And I'm not playing. I act this way because you have to. If not, you'll get well, you know what you'll get, right? And so, oh, I just thought about another story, but I'm not sure if okay, really quickly, I bumped into another acquaintance, right? And he said he started telling me, yeah, I got beat up by the cops and stuff like that. That he was with a group of people and then the cops were there and that he got off and he asked them, like the cop was asking the individuals for their names and IDs. And when the cop reached this acquaintance, which I am referring, he said, "What if I run?" And that the cop kind of stood like, "What?" He kind of like unexpected, like, "This isn't part of training, like you're not supposed to say that." And so he took off, right? And the cop, he gets in the car and starts chasing the acquaintance, right? And so I don't know how it is, but they end up like finding him and they ask him to turn around and to walk backwards with his hands in his air, and he just said that all he felt was like a baton just smack him in below his knee, and that they just ganged up on him and beat him up. And I'm thinking like, oh, can I tell you why that happened? And so I let him know it's because the cop felt humiliated because you were smart enough to be like, what if I don't give you my name? What if I just take off, And so that totally humiliated that rookie, and probably all his friends are making fun of him, And so I said, listen, honestly, you didn't do nothing wrong. First of all, you can tell that the officer is kind of like a he's a I don't want to like disrespect no one, but he's an a-hole, right? You could tell those cops, right, with the glasses and all that. And now he's got a gun and he wants you to give him something. I'd run too. I would feel threatened. And so these are the kind of points that we gotta be able to present with strong evidence in court and stuff like that. Because honestly, if a man with a weapon approaches me and he's asking for stuff, I feel like I'm being robbed. I don't care if he's got a little star right there. I have a cross right here, and that don't give me the right to kind of like hassle and harass people. These officers are there for us, to use when we need them, when we need their services. We don't need them to be hustling and you know, like, kind of like all up in our business when they are here to serve and protect. And yeah, I just want to conclude there. Also, like, if we don't got money in the economy, how come I live in a small city, about 35,000 people, but there's a group of cities together, right? But if you run a stop sign, you're gonna get like five vehicles in back of you, and they're all gonna like, they're waiting to I guess use their little toys or something like that. So yeah, it gets pretty delusional sometimes, right? But anyways, if our economy is not doing that great, I don't know, then explain to how come they all have like brand new RoboCop cars, right? And they're driving like nutcases all around the city, like in the city is not even a mile long, and these RoboCops are hauling at speeds up to like 80 miles per hour in a span of like 100 yards. I don't even know if the vehicle is capable of reaching that mileage per hour in the actual span that he's got to make the next stop, right? But anyways, I mean, you know, just if anyone knows, how come the police department is kind of stepping it up with the equipment and the vehicles and all that? How come it is said that we're in a down economy, right? And also, now speaking on economy, you know, I have an idea. If, because, you know, in school, about what, 10 years ago, when US decided to go murder innocent people in Afghanistan, they said that we were spending around $3 trillion a year. What if we don't spend those $3 trillion a year and put them back to education and spend them within the communities? You know, just an idea. But, you know, if we got $3 trillion to invest in death and murder and you know, and all of that, then what's all this about a bad economy? Listen, and this is not, well, this is gonna, this last message is it includes Rastafari, but most of all it's for, like, directed towards all the people all into politics, because they're probably the ones that cause most of these problems. The problem to the situation that confronts America today is we, the people of the United States, when it comes to saving life, to making good decisions, to putting oneself's interest aside for the better of the human community, when it comes to helping and aiding and you know, and curing and educating and furthering the progress in life, we, the people of the United States of America, we back down when it comes to murder, death, rape, stealing, and raping, everything. We Americans are all for that. As long as the, you know, this was even in the radio station, the economy's bad, the war is horrible, the situation's, it's out of control. But God forbid that the Super Bowl be canceled, you know, that just cannot happen. And so, you know, think about it. And for Rastafari, when His Imperial Majesty, you know, he introduced the Constitution to Ethiopia, this was like, it's how we are supposed to be INLAWS. We're supposed to participate and become a part of the law and enforce it. You know, His Majesty did not give up his power. He only shared it with all and die so that we can help him enforce truth and right and establish everything. It's all he did. Before, the emperor of the well, in this case, the emperor of the world, right? But he had all the responsibility from Menelik all the way to Dawit the first, Kedamawi Dawit. And so and so like it is our responsibility to be in laws, to be in the law, and to participate. And you know, if you see all these political parties, you could see all the minorities out there, but you cannot see the majority, and so that's got to change, right? And it, you know, it's all gonna happen. So, you know, already we went way past what we wanted to say. So, you know, give thanks. This was just an update for the end lives that is to come. Shalom, Rastafari.